Hello, friends. This is Dave Hurwitz, executive editor at ClassicsToday.com, here with another splendid box of really cool reissues from Australian Eloquence, in this case, Australian Eloquence Decca, or Decca Eloquence from Australia, or Deloquence from Austreca. However you want to do it, it's Jochum, the Philips Choral Music Recordings. These are wonderful. And I wanted to talk about this box a little bit because, you know, all of this stuff is in those big DG Jochum boxes, one way or another. Somehow, Philips doesn't exist. It can be either DG or it can be Decca, depending on what day of the week it is. It doesn't really make any difference. And whether it was originally on Decca or DG, it could also be a Philips recording. You could say it was Philips. Who knows? I've totally lost track of what Universal's material actually did, or what it's called, or how they categorize it, because they can always choose whatever they want from any of their labels and include it in a box under a different label, unless, of course, they really ought to choose the stuff to complete a box, in which case they'll pick something else. Never mind. The point is that Decca Eloquence, and particularly the Eloquence part, the guys in Australia know what they're doing. They really do. And it was very smart to take this stuff out separately, because it contains some really classic stuff. You get Jochum's Bach choral works. You get, or most of them. You get his, let's see, what else do we get here? We get the Haydn, the Creation. That's the one. The other one, the one that had to happen before you had Seasons. The Creation. That's really cool. And you get Beethoven's Missa Solemnis. And as an extra special treat, well, I don't know if it's a treat, but it is special, you get the Mengelberg Magnificat. That was a gift from Jochum to his Concertgebouw predecessor, I suppose. I mean, there's not much else reason to listen to it, let's be honest. But it's not, well, let's put it this way. It's not terrible, but it ain't Bach, it ain't Haydn, it ain't Beethoven. So let's see what we do get, because this is really, really, some of these things are classics, absolute classics. First of all, the B minor mass. Ah, the B minor mass. Yes, with soloists, let's see who they are. Lois Marshall, Herta Tipper, Peter Pears is the tenor. Good old Peter Pears. And this is in 57, when his voice was, well, I don't think his voice was ever what you would call young and fresh. I mean, it was always kind of Peter Pears-ish, but it was an earlier Peter Pears-ish. Let's call it that. And Kim Borg. And let's see, who else is in here? Oh, you got like lots of famous people. Anyway, it's with the Bavarian Radio Chorus and Orchestra from 1957. It's a live recording. Now, I have to be honest and tell you that if I had my choice, I would prefer for the B minor mass, Jochum's last one, because he went back to Bavaria with the same folks, and is one of his very, very last recordings. It was a digital recording, but it was for EMI, and he did the B minor mass in fabulous digital sound, and really a stunning performance. It really is. That was really the one. But this isn't bad. I mean, it's older, but it's good. It's pretty good. It really is pretty good. It's in stereo. Who are we complaining, right? Okay, next. Now we get the hot stuff. The St. Matthew Passion. This is one of the great, great, great St. Matthew Passions. And it's with Ernst Haefliger and Walter Berry and Agnes Giebel. And Martha Hüfgen, what's her name? I can't even see this thing again. Oh, Marga Hüfgen. Yes, Marga Hüfgen. And let's see, Johann van Kesteren. And it's really one of Franz Kraas. Wow, Franz Kraas, he's terrific. You know, this performance of the St. Matthew Passion is not as gaunt and terrifying as Klemperer's, nor is it necessarily as lively as the period instrument people, but it is glorious of its type. Jochum was working within the accepted tradition of Bach interpretation of his day, but he had something very, very personal to bring to the table. And that personal thing was a warmth and a humanity and a simple honesty, a sincerity of expression that is very, very moving, very affecting. He picks beautifully flowing tempos. The playing is always expressive, always meaningful, always inspired by the words and imbued with the sense of the text. It's just a gorgeous performance. And it's one of those B minor mass, St. Matthew Passion performances that really cheats the clock. I mean, you know how long that thing is. I mean, it's for penitential Lutherans with nothing to do, you know, on Good Friday or miserable Saturday or whichever thing comes next before Easter Sunday. And it was a long afternoon, really a long afternoon. And I happen to think the piece is one of the great shattering masterpieces of Western civilization, but I save it for special occasions. I really do. And I don't feel any obligation to listen to the whole thing at a sitting either, because the music is so, so glorious, but it really takes a tremendous amount out of you. And this is one of those performances that puts in as much as it takes out. Some performances make you feel, ugh, when it's over. You know, you just want to go, ugh. No, sorry, that's Japanese. But, you know, that wasn't a traditional Christian symbolic moment. But the fact of the matter is that this is a performance that is consoling and full of this sense of sadness but also hopefulness. It's just a wonderful performance. I love it. I just love listening to it. Just put it on and listen to it. It's amazing. And the same, I must say, holds true of the St. John Passion. Now, when I did my talk on the Bach, Major Bach Choral Works, the Idealist, and on normal instruments, I did two of them. There was one for period instrument performances and one for modern instrument performances. And a couple of these things were in there. They were in the lists of the great performances. There's no way you can leave these things out. The St. John Passion is, if anything, even better than the St. Matthew Passion because it's on a smaller scale, I think. And perhaps for that reason, it's not as weighty, and it's more amenable also to Jochum's very, very warm and humane approach to the music. It's more intimate. It's a beautifully, beautifully rendered performance. Let's see who's in this one. Let's see, oh, there's like all kinds of people in it. Oh my, look who the cello is. Look at the cello soloist. It's Honor Bylsma. Whoa, spelled somewhat differently. Is that who it is? Looks like it. I don't know. Maybe I didn't spell it right or pronounce it. Ernst Haefliger, Walter Berry, Agnes Giebel, Martha Höfgren, Alexander Young, Franz Kress. Well, we know them. We've heard them before, haven't we? Unless it's the same people. No, it's the same people. Basically, it's the Bach people, the Jochum Bach people. And I'm going back here just to make sure because it looks identical. Ooh, yeah. There they are. Just as good as they are in the St. Matt. They're fabulous in the St. John as well. And then we get the Weihnachts Oratorio. Now, I know some of you people think the greatest ever Weihnachts Oratorio, the Christmas Oratorio, is Richter's. And, you know, I find it hard to disagree. Certainly it has the best soloists for some. I don't know. Look at who you got here. I think this was my pick in the ideal list. You've got Ellie Ameling, the great Ellie Ameling, Birgitta Fassbender, the young and less, you know, wah, 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 Birgitta Fassbender, and Horst Laubenthal, and Hermann Pry, whose voice was just wonderful. And, oh my God, look at all these people, and then all these violinists and other famous people. This is just an amazing Christmas Oratorio. It's glorious, absolutely glorious, fabulously sung. Even if you love the Richter, you got to have this one too. You just got to have them both. So we're in really good shape so far, aren't we? I mean, you may not care so much about the older B minor mass, but for the Two Passions and the Christmas Oratorio, these are really hard to beat. And then we get Die Schöpfung. Oh, Haydn's The Creation. Now, we all know already that Jochum was a fabulous Haydn conductor. His set of the 12 London Symphonies on Deutsche Grammophon is wonderful. He did some others that were on Berlin Classics with the Staatskapelle at Dresden, which were even better. About four of them. Unfortunately, not a whole set, but they're amazing. And this performance of The Creation is delicious. It's absolutely delicious. It's fresh as the morning dew. It's just great. It's, again, Agnes Gebel, Waldemar Kment, Gottlob Frick. Remember Gottlob? Gottlob was the Schulte ring. He always did, like, Alberich or something. There was that Gustav Niedlinger. I don't know, one of those guys. But Gottlob Frick is a heavy, dark bass. Let's put it that way. I don't remember which Gottlob or Gustav or whatever did the ring, but he was a ring guy, too. And let's see, who else have we got here? Anybody we need to know? No. And this is Bavarian Radio from, let's see, what was the date on this one? 19-something. Yes, it was 19-something. I can't see. I'm not even going to try to see. Oh, 66. There we go. I think that's what it was. So it's a nice stereo, and it's just another one of those wonderful Jochum performances where everything is just as it should be. Modern performance, modern instruments, but so fresh, so alive, so musical. Then after the Mangelbird Magnificat, which is only like 9 minutes long, we go to the Missus Solemnis. Now, I've been listening to a lot of Missus Solemni lately because I have to at some point review the new René Jacobs Missus Solemnis, which is, well, who am I kidding? It's horrible, but I'll get to that formally later. But this one was one that people tend to pass it up. It's with the Concertgebouw, and again, we have Agnes Gebel and Martha Hefkin and Ernst Haeflinger and Carl Ritterbusch with the Netherlands Radio Chorus. Wonderful singing, really, really good singing, a very well integrated sound picture, the soloists and the chorus and the orchestra. That, I mean, they're all going nuts at the end of the Gloria, and they do go nuts at the end of the Gloria. It's so clear, and the fast, those rapid interchanges between the soloists and the chorus and with the orchestra punctuating, they're just wonderful. Jochum's performance is reverent. It's maybe a touch on the slow side. It takes about 81 minutes, but I have to say, better that than too light. The Missus Solemnis is not a piece that you want to take for granted, and it should not be like light and fluffy. It just shouldn't be. René Jacobs is light and fluffy. This is beautifully reverent, but never sluggish, never too slow, never excessively sentimental. It's the work of a, again, sincerity, musicality, expression of the text, the meaning of the words expressed through music. It's all so nicely and naturally done. And even if you may disagree with certain moments, it makes sense. You know, you feel like you're having an intelligent disagreement because you see the point that Jochum is making. It's absolutely gorgeous. I mean, the preambulum, whatever that thing is called, for solo violin before the Benedictus, it's so seraphic. It's so serene and beautiful. And the distant trumpets and drums and the Agnus Dei and the Dona Nobis Pacem, you know, and the sound of war is approaching, which, by the way, Beethoven stole from Haydn. But who's talking? You know, we're not worried about that. I mean, it's really menacing. It's really effective. I mean, that's what I mean. You know, some people today, they play this stuff as if it's some kind of abstraction. I mean, like there's no deep emotional immediate meaning to these sounds that we're hearing. But Jochum got it, and he projected it, and it's just great. Absolutely great. I love this Missus Solemnis. I have come to listen to it more and more. I mean, since the Big DG box came out, when I first gave it another shot, and then I have it in here, and I, you know, it will surprise you. Why was it? You have to ask yourself, why was it that Jochum's work was so roundly dismissed or just sort of ignored? He was like DG's third conductor because they had Carrion and they had Boehm and they had, and he was sometimes on Phillips and sometimes on DG. He was kind of bouncing around, and his specialty was Bruckner, who nobody cared about until the world went insane, and now everybody cares about him, but for all the wrong reasons. It really is astonishing when you come back and listen to these recordings. I mean, thank God they made them. And because really, I mean, this was repertoire that DG was doing with other people. And for that reason, I think Jochum's own work tended to be downplayed. And he didn't have the PR. He wasn't that kind of a guy. He was just a genuine, heartfelt, serious, incredibly gifted musician. And you know that when somebody is not glamorous, but they're just musical, they will be ignored. It's an absolute rule. Even in the world of classical music, where you know, musical values are theoretically paramount, there are far, far more people who would rather talk about music or posture with it or display it somehow or use it as a hood ornament than there are people who prefer to make music and listen, really listen to music. But you, my friends, are all fabulous listeners. And because I know that you will always keep on listening, I know that this Jochum Box is for you. So thank you for joining me. Take care.